This is the book of Obadiah, verse 6 to 10. How are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hidden things sought up? All the men of thy confederacy have brought thee even to the border. The men that were at peace with thee have deceived thee and prevailed against thee. They that eat thy bread have laid a wound under thee. There is none understanding in him. Shall I not in that day, saith the Lord Yahweh, even destroy the wise men out of Edom, and understanding out of the mount of Esau? And thy mighty men, O Teman, shall be dismayed, to the end that every one of the mount of Esau may be cut off by slaughter. For thy violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall cover thee, and thou shalt be cut off forever. Obadiah chapter 1, verse 6 through 10. Shalom. I want to start off by giving all praises, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, Racha Kodesh. Double honors to our venerable apostles and elders at Great Millstone who rule well, and peace and blessings to the Lord's elect, the house of David. All right, it's the brother Aharon coming back at you with another lesson. Lord willing to be edifying and uplifting unto the elect. All right, and just wanted to share some information that I came across. All right, and this is all going into, all right, the biblical prophecy, all right, that states that in the last days, all right, those who have the power, okay, those who have been given the power by the Heavenly Father to rule this world, okay, their time is up. All right, and they've ruled this world under a vibration of wickedness, okay, through deception, all right, through robbery, fraud, okay, and ultimately through violence, whether it be covertly or overtly. All right, whether it be wars, okay, or whether it be the poison that they put in the food and how they use the media to control the minds of people and so on and so forth, these devils have had an agenda, all right, to destroy the minds of the world into thinking that they are the people of God, okay? But their everything that they do, all right, points to them being the very Edomites that the Bible describes, all right, as the power who rules this earth before the return of our Messiah. Okay, now the Messiah, the same Messiah that they don't believe in, all right, is the one who's going to come down to destroy their kingdom and to set up his kingdom here on earth. All right, we believe that through faith and through prophecy. Okay, now I'm going to get a quick precept here. All right, to show you that this earth is actually ruled by the wicked. Okay, this is the book of Job chapter 9 and verse 24. It says the earth is given into the hand of the wicked. Okay, now when you look at the people who have the so-called power, all right, on this earth, all right, they don't have the intentions of good for the majority of the people. All right, as a matter of fact, they actually believe in something known as depopulation. Okay, they believe that, and very soon, all right, here America is the last stand that's between them and their so-called New World Order. Okay. And they're going to do whatever. When I say they, we're talking about these people that have the power over the earth. All right. You have images that they put in your faces, like people like Klaus Schwab. OK, he's just a face. All right. But he has a form of power over the people. OK. Gil Bates. All right. He's also another one. All right. Elon Musk. OK. Jeff Bezos. These are just names and faces that people are familiar with. All right. And as we associate them through prophecy, all right, as being the wicked, okay, because they work directly under the rule of Satan. Okay, they come in the power of Satan. All right, they don't believe in God, they don't read the Bible, they don't, you know, adhere to the laws of the scriptures. So what are they? They're adversary to the scriptures, they're adversary to the Bible. Okay, they don't go to church. You know, the highest church they'll ever go to is a Catholic church. Okay, and that's all Satanism, as we've brought out timeless, countless times. Okay. But again, the prophecy states that these devils are going to be searched out in these last days. There's an inquisition being made, okay? And I saw the elder Yashwamba's video, all right? And that's actually something that inspired me to do this video, and alongside the elder Malcolm, okay? That this is the time where we have the questions. Now they have to answer our questions, okay? We've answered pretty much all their questions. What else haven't we answered, okay? Whatever topic they brought up, whatever controversy has risen, guess what? The Lord has used his men to what? To break down the strongholds, man. okay? By using the truth, the facts, all right? No BS, okay? We can go into the history, we go into the prophecy, we give you the truth. And now because of that, look what's going on around the world, okay? But again, the earth is given into the hands of the wicked, all right? It says he covered the faces of the judges thereof, if not where and who is he? Okay, so how did he, through time, through history, through hundreds of years of deception and manipulation, all right, distortion of history and truth, all right, how did they get to where they are now, where people actually look at the devil, very, very, very much so, look at them in the face and say, oh, those are God's people. How? And then you look at God's actual people, the Israelites, and you don't even consider anything that we're saying. We're bringing out the truth. We're telling you, according to scriptures, the prophecy states, all right, that when the Lord comes back, he's going to return his children, which are the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, Judah, Benjamin, Levi, Ephraim, Manasseh, Gad, Reuben, Asher, Issachar, okay, Naphtali, all right, Simeon. The Lord said he's bringing all his children back. Okay. And that's going to happen when the Lord comes back, when the Messiah actually returns back on this earth, something known as the Advent, all right, the so-called second coming, how the church actually refers to it as, okay? But the Lord is coming back and he's going to put his children back in their land, okay? It's a restoration. As when the Lord was leaving, okay, let's see if we can get that real quick, okay? What did the disciples ask him? All right, we asked him, all right, Lord, will you now, let's get this real quick. This is the book of Acts chapter 1 and verse 6. It says, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? See, it's a kingdom of Israel, not a Jewish state in 1948. Okay, it's not a restoration of a Jewish state. There was no such thing as a Jewish state to begin with. You're not going to restore something that never existed. Okay. So prior to 1948, who was in that land? Okay, prior to 70 AD, who was in that land? Right, we have to go back into that history, and that's exactly what we're going to do. Again, scriptures talk about breaking down the strongholds. All right, we're going to do that with what? With truth. Okay, we're a truth-based group, and that's it. No propaganda. Okay, no BS, just straight facts. All right. It says, it is an incontestable fact, the word Jew. Okay. And this is all we're reading from a book. All right. And we're trying to draw, bringing out the facts. We're drawing out the facts. Okay. This is what education means, to draw out. Okay. To bring out. Okay. So it says, it is an incontestable fact. The word Jew, J-E-W, right, did not come into existence until the year 1775. Prior to 1775, the word J-E-W did not exist in any language. Let's read that again. Prior to 1775, okay, how many years ago is that? 1775, 1875 will be what, 100 years? 1975, 200 years. Well, we're not there yet. So 200 and some change. Okay. So prior to 1775, the word J-E-W did not exist in any language. The word J-E-W was introduced into the English for the first time in the 18th century when Sheridan used it in a play, The Rivals. Now, that's debatable because you have other scholars who actually, basically debate when the first time, you know, the word J-E-W was ever witnessed, right? But it was around the same time. Okay, the point is, it's not something that's you can relate back to the ancient biblical Hebrews, because the letter J didn't exist during that time. Okay, the letter J didn't exist, and the letter the word J-E-W, as we're reading here, came about during the 1700s. Okay, 1775 to be exact, based on what we're reading here. Okay, so prior to that, what were they being called? Okay, so let's read. Again, the scripture says, you being sought out, all right? The truth, there's an inquisition being made, and the truth is what people are looking for, okay? And now you're on trial, and the verdict is coming down. It's all prophecy. Okay, there's nothing you can do about it. All right? So let's keep going. It says, quote, she shall have skin like a mummy and the beard of a J-E-W. Because it's part of our custom. Okay? As an Israelite man, you're supposed to grow out your beard. Okay? That's part of the law. All right? It says, prior to the use of the word J-E-W in the English language by Sheridan in 1775, the word J-E-W had not become a word in the English language. Shakespeare, William Shakespeare, at which he was a Jake. All right. Shakespeare is a Jake. You know, people think that he's a so-called white guy. And all. No. That's all part of the Renaissance bullshit deception. All right. That we're breaking down right now with the truth. Okay. So Shakespeare never saw the word J-E-W, as you will see. Shakespeare never used the word J-E-W in any of his works, the common general belief to the contrary notwithstanding. In his Merchant of Venice, it's a very interesting book, Shakespeare wrote as follows, what is the reason? Am I a you? Huh. Hath not a you eyes? You see? So the U, it was an I-E-W-E. That's how they spelt that word, U. So the J wasn't even there. Okay? Anyway, it says in the Latin, St. Jerome, 4th century Vulgate edition of the New Testament, what we're going to use, Jesus, right, is referred to by the genitive plural of Eudaeus in the Gospel, and it's spelled I-U-D-A-E-U-S. Eudaeus. Okay? In the Gospel of John, reference to the inscription on the cross, Eudarium, all right, spelt I-U-D-A-E-O-R-U-M, Eudarium, okay? It was in the 4th century, okay, that St. Jerome translated into Latin the manuscripts of the New Testament from the original languages, which was what? And the New Testament was predominantly written in Greek. Okay, that's why whenever we go back into these words in the English, you have to go back to the origin or the root words, which are all in Greek. Okay, you get that in the Old Testament, it's mostly in Hebrew, and in the New Testament is Greek. Okay. So continuing, it says, this translation by Saint Jerome is referred to still today as the Vulgate edition by the Roman Catholic Church authorities who use it today. Yahushai, or what they call so-called Jesus, is referred to as a so-called J-E-W for the first time in the New Testament in the 18th century. Huh. Let's read that again. G, or Jesus, all right, Jesus, is referred to as a so-called J-E-W for the first time in the New Testament in the 18th century. So prior to that, what would he be identified as? What was the word that they were using? Let's read. Jesus, or Yahushai, is first referred to as a so-called J-E-W in the revised 18th century edition in the English language of the 14th century first translations of the New Testament into English. Okay? It says, the history of the origin of the word J-E-W in the English language leaves no doubt that the 18th century J-E-W is the 18th century contracted and corrupted English word for the 4th century Latin Eudaeus. Okay? Found in St. Jerome's Vulgate edition. Of that, it says, of that there is no longer doubt. The available original manuscripts from the 4th century to the 18th century accurately trace the origin and give the complete history of the word J-E-W in the English language. In these manuscripts, it says, in these manuscripts are to be found all the many earlier English equivalents extending through the 14th century from the 4th to the 18th century, from the Latin Eudaeus to the English J-E-W. Okay. It says these English forms included successively Jew, which is spelled G-Y-U. Okay. Jew, which is spelled G-I-U. You, which is spelled I-U. Which, remember, the I or the J is an extension of the I. Okay. Remember that. I remember I went to, there was a port. I believe a couple of years ago, I went to a port around the East Coast. It had to be somewhere on Long Island. And we went to this harbor port. And, you know, the writing that they had from, I believe they said prior to the 19th century. Okay. When you read the way they were writing, the I was more of a J. You know, so they extended it. When you look at the documents from prior to 19th century and post 19th century, you see the difference of what was written. The letter I is extended and becomes a J. Okay, so it makes sense why successively prior to the 18th century, okay, they have IU, which would be pronounced Jew. Okay, but it's actually a J. Remember, the I is extended, right? Another one is Jew, as in I-U-U. Okay? Another one is Jew, spelled I-U-W. Another one is spelled Jew, as in I-E-U-U. There's another one, I-E-U-Y, Jewy. Another Jew, I-W-E, I-O-W, I-E-W-E, I-E-U-E, I-U-E, I-U, but it's typed in a V, but it's a U. Remember, if you read the Old English, even in the King James 1611 version, you will see the U normally is typed in as a V, right? So it's a little confusing, but if you understand what you're reading, you know what word means what, okay? And then finally, in the 18th century, J-E-W. So prior to the 18th century, they didn't have the word Jew, or the way at least how it's spelled today. Okay, the many earlier English equivalents for J-E-Ws through the 14th centuries are G-I-W-I-S, G-I-W-S, G-Y-U-E-S, G-Y-W-E-S, G-I-W-E-S, G-E-U-S, I-U-Y-S, I-O-W-S, I-O-U-I-S, I-E-W-S. These are all different spellings. Okay, these are all different spellings of the same word, which is spelled today as J-E-W-S. Okay, so let's keep going. It says, and then also finally in the 18th century, J-E-W-S. Okay, good. Let's continue. It says, with the rapidly expanding use in England in the 18th century for the first time in history of the greatly improved printing presses, unlimited quantities of the New Testament were printed. These revised 18th century editions of the earlier 14th century first translations into the English language were then widely distributed throughout England and the English-speaking world among families who had never possessed a copy of the New Testament in any language. You see? That's part of the deception. Remember, all the way back to the 14th century. That's pretty much around that time where the Renaissance starts to pick up. Okay? The so-called revival of Greek and Roman text. Okay? And that's where the deception comes in. It tells you in the book of Revelation that Satan is going to be loose for a short season to what? To deceive the nations. Okay? So that's part of the deception. It goes through not just financially, okay, but also religiously. All right, that's one of the biggest ways of deceiving the world, okay, is to tap into their spiritual. It says, in these 18th century editions with revisions, the word J-E-W appeared for the first time in any English translations. The word J-E-W, as it was used in the 18th century editions, has since continued in use in all editions of the New Testament in the English language. There you go, okay? The use of the word J-E-W thus was stabilized. They have to first stabilize something, right? Ingrain it in the minds of the people. Then you can build on that. You see? So we're going to tell you exactly what they're going to do next. First, they're going to start pushing in with their diversion tactics, which, Lord willing, I might do a separate lesson on which ones exactly they might use, all right? Because they're already planting the seed, so you can see it, okay? Which is the whole divert, just like a snake, right? What does a snake normally do? A serpent, when it's seen, when it doesn't want to be seen, what does it do? It quickly runs into some type of trouble or some way, somehow. If it's an open field, that nigga's going to be out. He's going to glide his way through that open field all the way till he gets to bush or somewhere where he can hide, okay, and then regroups and then just slithers all away so no one can see him, right? But in this case, you have people chasing after the serpent, so then it's a fight and flight response at the same time, right? So first is going to be flight, so they're on the run, as you can see, but then slowly but surely they get backed up into a corner, right? That's where the questions have become, okay, we can't answer these questions, we have to demonize, we have to attack, okay? Then you're going to start seeing the dehumanization tactics, the crisis acting, the FFs, the false flags, right? All that bullshit, they're going to pull it all, okay? And then use the drive it home with the media propaganda to spike fear, okay? And then they're going to come in and say, well, these are the people who are tied into this. We need to protect you from them. And anyone who were seen associating themselves with these people, you're in trouble because you're anti this and you're pro this. And you're anti that. It's all a game. We're going to expose all that eventually. So let's keep going. It says, as you know, the best known 18th century editions of the New Testament in English are the Rheims, which is spelled R-H-E-I-M-S, edition of the King James Authorized Edition. The Rheims translation of the New Testament into English was first printed in 1582, but the word J-E-W did not appear in it. Huh. So if it didn't appear in it, what word appeared in there? Let's find out. It says the King James Authorized translation of the New Testament into English was begun in 1604 and first published in 1611. The word J-E-W did not appear in it either. The word J-E-W appeared in both these well-known editions in their 18th century revised versions for the first times. Countless copies of the revised 18th century editions of the Rheims and the King James translations of the New Testament into English were distributed to the clergy, okay, and the laity throughout the English speaking world. Now, why is that? It says they did not know the history of the origin of the English word J-E-W, nor did they care. They accepted the English word J-E-W as the only word, or as the only and as the accepted form of the Latin Judaeus. All right, Judaeus. It says, and the Greek Judaeus, okay, or Judaeus, which is spelled I-O-U-D-A-I-O-S. All right, and that's all, again, what was actually in the original translations from Greek to English. Okay, it wasn't J-E-W, it was more of I-O-U-D-A-I-O-S instead of J-E-W. Okay, how could they be expected to have known otherwise? The answer is they could not, and they did not. It was a new English word to them. When you studied Latin, you're taught that the letter I in Latin, when used as the first letter in a word, is pronounced like the letter Y in English. Okay, when it is the first letter in words like yes, youth, or yacht, the I in Judaeus is pronounced like the Y in yes, youth, and yacht in English. In all the 4th century to 18th century forms, for the 18th century J-E-W, the letter I was pronounced like the English Y in yes, young and yacht. The same is true for the G-I or the G-Y, where it was used in place of the letter I, which is ye, pronounced Y, ye, yes, right? The present pronunciation of the word J-E-W in modern English is a development of recent times. Interesting. Again, these are the people who claim that they were they before, right? They were there before. They were they and there before, right? Let's read. It says, in the English language today, the J in J-E-W is pronounced like the J in the English, justice, jolly, and jump. This is the case only since the 18th century. Prior to the 18th century, the J in J-E-W was pronounced exactly like the Y in English. Yes, youth and yacht, right? So it's use, okay? Until the 18th century, and perhaps even later than the 18th century, the word J-E-W in English was pronounced like the English you or you. And the word J-E-W or J-E-W's like use or use. Okay? The present pronunciation of J or J-E-W in English is a new pronunciation acquired after the 18th century. Okay? The German language still retains the Latin original pronunciation. The German Jude is a German equivalent of the English Jew. You hear that? That's interesting. The J in the German Jude is pronounced exactly like the English Y in yes, youth, and yacht. The German J is the equivalent of the Latin I. You see? So again, English is a bastard language, like we always say, because it's a combination of so many different other languages. All right, when you actually go into certain words in English, you come across the fact that some of it is more of a compound word. So it's a combination of two different words, right? For example, the word psychology. Okay, psychology is a Greek word. Okay, but in English, you think of it as, oh, it's the study of, you know, the mind or whatever, you know. No, psychology is actually the study of the soul. You know, when you break it down, all right, the word psych goes into the Greek word psyche, which means your soul, right? Or your spirit or whatever, right? And the ology means to study or the study of, right? So psychology is a compound word. So again, that's a word that comes from the Greek, okay? You have other words that go back to Latin, all right? Other words that go back to French, okay? And we use it all in the English language. You know, so it's the same thing with the letter I being extended into a J and incorporated into English language and pronounced as a J instead of a Y, as it was before or prior to the 18th century. Okay, let's see. I'm gonna skip a little bit of this. It's pretty much repetitive ways, different ways of saying the same thing is what's happening here. Let's read some more. It says, the English language, as you already know, is largely made up of words adopted from foreign languages. There you go. I just said that, so we're going to skip all that. Or maybe it might be interesting. Let's read. It says, after the adoption by the English language, foreign words were then adapted by contracting their spelling and corrupting their foreign pronunciation to make them more easily pronounced in English from their English spelling. This process of first adopting foreign words and then adapting them by contracting their spelling and corrupting their pronunciation resulted in such words in the English language as cab from the French cabriolet and many thousands of other words similarly from their original foreign spelling. So as I was saying, there's evidence right there to back it up with a beautiful example, right? Hundreds of others must come to your mind. Yeah. It says, by this adapting process, the Latin Judaeus and the Greek Judaeus finally emerged in the 18th century as J-E-W in the English language. The English-speaking peoples struggled through 14th centuries seeking to create for the English language an English equivalent for the Latin Judaeus and the Greek Judaeus, which could be easily pronounced in English from its English spelling. The English J or J-E-W was a resulting 18th century contracted and corrupted form of the Latin Judaeus and the Greek Judaeus. The English J-E-W is easily pronounced in English from its English spelling. The Latin Judaeus and the Greek Judaeus or Judaeus Eudaios, cannot be easily pronounced in English from the Latin and Greek spelling. They were forced to coin a word. Do you hear that? They were forced to coin a word. And today that word is known as J-E-W with a ish behind it. Oh man, this is so sad. It's so, so sad. Let's see, maybe I can get a little bit more. Right here, this part right here might kill them. Let's read. It says, in the Tyndale edition of the New Testament in English, published in 1525, Yahushai, or in this spelt Jesus, was likewise described as one of the ewes. In the Coverdale edition published in 1535, Yahushai was also described as one of the ewes. In the Coverdale edition, the Gospel by John reads Jesus, right? Which is spelled with the I, not a J, of Nazareth, King of the ewes. And King is spelled K-Y-N-G-E. Interesting, yeah? All right, of the ewes, okay? In the Cranmer edition published in 1539, Yahushai was again described as one of the ewes. In the Geneva edition published in 1540 to 1557, Yahushai was also described as one of the ewes. In the Rhymes edition published in 1582, Yahushai was described as one of the ewes. The King James edition published in 1604 to 1611, also known as the Authorized Version, Yahushai was described again as one of the ewes. The forms of the Latin Eudaeus were used, which were current at the time these translations were made. Okay? Wow. So much to unpack here. Let me see if I can pick out some more of the good stuff here. Right here it says, there is not a person in the whole English-speaking world today who regards a J-E-W as a Judean in the literal sense of the word. Woo! Okay. I think I might have to save that for another day. Let me see. Just give a little bit more before I stop. All right. That was the correct and only meaning in the 18th century. The generally accepted secondary meaning of the word J-E-W today, with practically no exceptions, is made up of four almost universally believed theories. The four theories are that the so-called or self-styled J-E-Ws is 1. A person who today professes the form of religious worship known as Judaism. So these are the forms of what you know as J-E-Ws today. Okay, those who claim to be J-E-Ws but are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Yes, they actually SOS. Yes, it's part of what they do. Okay, now when you look at the American government or all the world governments, all the people who are in power positions and power seats all trace back to the J's. Okay, it's all there. All right, so it's not that hard to find. It says 2, a person who claims to belong to a racial group associated with the ancient Semites. Okay, now Esau Edom is a Semite. Okay, so he's well in his right to call himself a Semite. That's fine and dandy. But guess what? Within the Semites, all right, well, they call Semites, they're Shemites, according to the scriptures. Within the Shemites, you have different sons. Shem had multiple sons. As a matter of fact, let's see if we can pull that up. Okay. See if we can get that in the book of Genesis. Okay, let's see. Genesis, I want to go to the 11th chapter. Let's see. We're going to get some stuff here. See if I can pull this up. Okay. So right here, the book of Genesis chapter 10. Start off at, start off at 22. All right, it says, the children of Shem, Elam, and Ashur, and Arphaxad, and Lud, and Aram. Okay, so the Elamites are Shemites. Okay, the Ashurites are Shemites. Anyone who comes from the line of Arphaxad, which is the Israelites come from the line of Arphaxad, are Shemites. Okay, Lud are Shemites, and Aram, okay, are Shemites. Okay, so you can't just say, oh, well, it's anti-Semitic. The people, the majority of the people who are around that area that you're having that beef with are Shemites for the most part. So, you know what I'm saying? It's like, again, they're deceptive ways. Okay, they're deceptive Edomite, you know, ways of doing things that's being exposed, and they're getting mad. So they're just coming up with words to describe or to put a target on other people and to hide from the truth. You see what I'm saying? But it's not going to work. Okay? So we're going back to the reading. And then we're going to close it out in a little bit. We won't make this too long. All right. The third part, or the third of the four theories of a so-called or self-styled J, is a person directly the descendant of an ancient nation which thrived in Palestine in Bible history, which can't be them. A person blessed by divine international or intentional design with certain superior cultural character denied to other racial, religious, or national groups are rolled into one, or all rolled into one. Okay? It says the present generally accepted secondary meaning of the word JEW is fundamentally responsible for the confusion in the minds of Christians regarding elementary tenets of the Christian faith. It is likewise responsible today to a very great extent for the delusion of the devotion of countless Christians for the Christian faith, or for their Christian faith. The implications, inferences, and innuendos of the word JEW today to the preponderant majority of intelligent and informed Christians is contradictory and in complete conflict with incontestable historical fact. You hear that? So even modern-day Christianity, they all lost. Because they also fall under the spell of that confusion that's set by Esau Edom. Okay, through their religious clergymen and the distortion of the words or certain words in the Bible that's been passed along for the people to read. Okay? Christians who cannot be fooled any longer are suspect of the Christian clergy who continue to repeat and repeat and repeat ad nauseum their pet theme song, Jesus Was a Jew. It actually now approaches a psychosis. All right, and we're going to stop right there. All right, again, this was a little bit more of a hitter. All right, you know, but again, I'm just doing it to test to see how the algorithm takes it, because, you know, we're in the time where you bring out the facts, they clip your channels, they clip your videos and all kinds of shit. You know, I've said less things and got my videos clipped. You know, so, you know, you have to be very careful with how you say certain things. But again, this was, you know, heavy hitter, so I'm just bringing it out, you know, but it's all for edification, you know. And, you know, if it stays up, hey, it stays up. If not, Lord willing, I'll put it up on my Rumble and BitChute. You know, I haven't really been using those accounts, but, you know, Lord willing, especially with the way things are going now, you know, I'm gonna have to start activating those channels. But, you know, it's all through the Spirit, you know. So again, I'll be bringing out more of this information, because it is the time, right? Let's get that real quick. Now is the time, man. Okay, because these devils been living a luxurious life for all these years, and now that they're being questioned, you know, their history is being questioned. Now all of a sudden, everybody's is a hate group. No, it doesn't work that way. Okay, there's a book of Psalm chapter 73 and verse 3. It says, "For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked." Okay, and they do all this wickedness. There's a scripture, I believe, in the book of Proverbs, if I'm not mistaken, where it talks about how, you know, certain wicked people enjoy prosperity at the hands of the righteous, you know, and then the righteous suffer persecution, you know, and they even done nothing wrong. You know, all that is vanity and vexation of spirit. And the Lord is going to check all that. You know, when the kingdom comes, ultimately those who are at the bottom are going to be at the top. Okay, so it says verse 4, "For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm." Okay, they always have backup plans. They have hedge funds and all that stuff that they have preserved for their children, you know. So they're always good to go, but those who actually need it, we never have anything. And the little that we have, they take it with their fraudulent schemes, taxes and fees and bills and all kinds of shit, man. Okay? Insurance, fraud, man. Straight up fraud, bro. Or go to school and get a degree. For what? For what? To be in a state of what we see today as America? This place is finished. Okay? And remember, when the time of martial law comes, you're going to see the true power. And you're also going to see the true nature of these beasts, man. All right? You people Americans think you have laws and you have freedoms and, you know, your government is out there looking out for you and all that. You wait and see. All right? They're going to turn their military against their own people, man. You wait and see. All right? Under UN orders. All right? United Nations and the who that. You see. Just watch. All right? They're building up a case. You see. All right, so continuing says, they are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. All right, they're always chilling. Okay, tell me one so-called JEW today that lives a life of fear. They don't live a life of fear. Maybe the ones at the bottom, it may be them, but that's shit. That's your fault. That's your problem. You should have pressed on your higher ups, your Rothschild family members, to send some of that $500 million in gold that they got stashed up somewhere. They could split that, you know, so you can get a little something. Because this is your kingdom, all right? And your kingdom is going down, but that's okay because you've enjoyed enough, all right? You didn't do nothing good. Shit, all you did was wickedness, you know? But the Lord is going to intensify, all right, the wickedness and the hatred that you always had for Jacob, okay? Look at the time of slavery, all right? Look at all the stuff that our people have suffered at the hands of the so-called Europeans, all right? We was out there in Africa minding our own business. You came over there and made war, shackled us up, and brought us over here till today, all right? Still tormenting us, man. And now we wake up to who we are, and you want to deny that? You took everything away from us, and the very one thing, which is our faith in Yahweh Bashem Yahushua, you want to come against that? You got another thing coming, bitch. All right? So let's keep going. Verse 6, it says, therefore, pride compasseth them about as a chain. That's why they think it's okay. They could just jump into any country and demand whatever. And if you say no, they make war against you, but then they tell the world that you're the evil one, that they got to protect themselves against you. How is it that you are on the offense, but yet you're telling the world that you're defending your people who are held hostage? You're fighting for your hostages. You can come. It's funny because, and it shows you how much bullshit this shit is. It's funny because yesterday I saw a headline that says so-called Hamas is going to agree to a stop, to a ceasefire on Thursday at 10 a.m. I'm like, you motherfuckers be having interviews with terrorist groups and shit. Like, how do they get them to sit down and have conversations and be sending them videos and be talking shit? Like, yeah, we're going to do this and we're not going to stop. We're going to stand here. We're going to fight against them because I'm like, isn't this a so-called terrorist group? You set up a TV interview with a terrorist group and the authorities didn't come and arrest it. It's like, it's games, bro. It's all theatrics. All right. It's all theatrics to put that fear in people. And you got these stupid ass people that eat it up. Oh, Israel's under attack. They have the right to defend themselves. Well, the Palestinians don't have a right to defend themselves. What about all these other nations that Americans have made war against? What about them? Huh? We can go into the history. We can go into it. Continue, it says, therefore, pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. That's all they know. Okay, pride and violence. Those two things go together with this devil. Okay? That's why they tried going to Africa, trying to push that bullshit LGBT shit. They said, nah, we ain't with that. All of a sudden, oh, we got to make war against these niggas. You know, whether it be sanctions, whether it be tariffs, whatever. Ultimately, whether it's by creating or setting up a puppet government in your shit, and then they make war against you for those who resist the puppet. This is what these devils like to do. Okay, that's their track record. Okay? But in the end, they call us a hate group. You devils, the nerve, man, the nerve. That's why you're going down. You're not honest. Okay, you're a bunch of devils and liars, and you use the media to lie to the people over and over again. You come up with shit and then use the media to lie and keep lying and keep lying. Guess what? Them days are over and you're being exposed. Your propaganda is being exposed. Your lies are being exposed. Your agendas are being exposed. All right, with this truth, and you don't know what to do about yourself. All right, but guess what? You're going down. you're going down. And all the nations are applauding that. Okay? They're applauding that. All right? To see the downfall of the wicked. Okay? So continue, it says, their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. Okay? They have all the power in the world. So now what do they want? The ultimate power to own humanity, to be in total control, to be a god on this earth. You see, that's them. Nobody else on this earth thinks like that except for them. And they tell you. So you can't say, oh, there's a conspiracy. These niggas are telling you that very soon human beings are hackable animals and they're going to be the ones to call the shots and, you know, create a new world and all. They come out and tell you this. So if you ain't listening, that's on you. Understand, you also on their menu when they're coming around. So you stay over there and believe what you want to believe. It says they are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. Okay. Oh, get over it. You know, oppression. What are you talking about? Oppression? No, you guys are not oppressed. We are oppressed. That's anti-Semitic if you say that. No. You need to support us. Whatever you went through as a people, shit, fuck that. Forget about that. Look at us. What did we go through? A Holocaust. Well, let's read the definition of a Holocaust real quick, right? A sacrificial offering burnt whole or woolly consumed, a form of oblation practiced by the JEWs, as well as some pagan nations, hence the complete sacrifice or surrender of anything as an act of atonement or consecration to the Most High. Okay, so on the right hand side, right, when we make those sacrifices to the Heavenly Father, as is written in the law, whether it be a sin offering or, you know, which predominantly will be a sin offering because it talks about an atonement. Okay, so when you atone for your sins, okay, there's a sacrifice that's being made. All right, so in that case, yes, by the very definition of the word Holocaust, it's a sacrificial burning that is done. Okay, but also these devils on the left hand side, they do that shit all the time. Okay, when you drop a missile or a nuclear missile on anywhere, a bomb anywhere, and you cause all the casualties that you're causing, right, that's an Holocaust. Okay, you're burning people alive with fire. Look what happened to what's this place, this place in Hawaii. Damn, I can't believe this thing just slipped my mind. It was the talk of the town a couple of months ago. It'll come back to me, but look what happened over there. Straight up desert land. Fire cooked the whole place up with that DEW thing, you know? So it's all coming out, man. It's all coming out, you know? We're going to finish it off real quick. It says, they set their mouth against the heavens and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore, his people return hither and waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. They say, how doth the Most High know, and is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Okay. And that's who's the ungodly? The so-called J's. And how do they profit in riches? By deception, by fraud, by thievery. Okay. By murder. All right. And that's what they're trying to do again. The whole Gaza shit that they're doing is because they've discovered some natural resources, oil, gas. Okay. And they want to what? They want the people over there to surrender the land. And that's how they do what they do. We found some resources in your land. We're going to wage war against you and come take over your shit. And that's Esau Edom's MO. All right. But anyway, I'm going to leave it off there. Lord willing, you are edified. I want to give all praises, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, Rechakwadash, the water Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai. And until next time, Shalom.